this is the making of Transatlantic's Bridge Across Forever. And Phil was kind enough to put all this stuff together for us. We've shot tons and tons of footage of all kinds of stuff, from Mike falling out of his car, I remember that, and to like Rich's house being all, you know, the Echoplex in the bathroom, and yeah, all kinds of stuff, to the drum cam and, you know, everything at the studio. And so we shot a lot of stuff this time.
Well, we reconvened in January 2000, and it was decided that we would make the second transatlantic trip to Nashville, Tennessee, or right outside of it, and we were going to do the album on Neal's stomping grounds.
So, welcome to the world of transatlantic, and here's the making of Bridge Across Forever. Pete's room, and I look over, there's bass pedals, and I'm like, now how many people are going to have bass? Who else? Right? You know, if there's bass pedals, a prog bass player cannot be far behind. Yeah. How's it going, man?
Good.
I'm all set for you. The bass pedals, ladies and gentlemen.
Do you happen to know how much that is?
There they are.
60 cents. Oh, God.
Hi, Pete.
Hi.
Hi, Roine. We're waiting for Mike to come out of his hotel.
This symbolizes the start of a new session.
Oh, is this a big moment? I didn't realize this was a big moment.
This means we're going from family man to drumming man.
Oh. Wow, I thought it was the other way around, man. Like boots to rock in and tennis shoes to play with the kids. I guess not. I guess I got it all wrong, man. The Morse estate. Here it is.
Yo.
Okay. Yo.
Word.
Word up, man.
We are now truly transatlantic.
We are, aren't we?
We've performed in London. We recorded in New York. Now we shall record in Nashville. All that's left is.
I think we shall. Land. Maybe. I don't know. Maybe we'll just, like,
Sweden.
Hang out and wait for Mike some more. Whoa!
You know, I feel bad. I didn't realize how completely out of the way this was.
The whole transatlantic experience for me is something that I thoroughly enjoy, something I'm thoroughly proud of. Because when I thought of this group of guys and this project years ago, it had nothing to do with selling records or playing shows, or it had nothing to do with pleasing you, the listener. It had completely to do with me just wanting to make some music with these guys. You know, I was a huge Spock Spears fan. And I have the utmost respect for Neal as a writer. And I just really wanted to work with the guy. And the same goes for Roine and Pete.
The Mike Portnoy commemorative signature series snare drum.
It's the first time this is going to be used. And then there's...
Cool.
It also comes in a smaller...
It size. Comes in its own container. Oh, no, that's cup of noodles.
There's this one, too.
Well, I thought that was funny.
You're weird.
Is it true? Don't tell me. Ah, oh, baby one.
You're like a baby one.
All right, cool.
I like that finish.
Here we are in my studio office here, trying to get set up. There, oh, where is it? Where is it?
Oh, it's over there.
Oh, wow. There's the whole gig right there, the double neck Rickenbacker. Hold it up now, come on.
We gathered in January, and we had about 10 days, a week or 10 days, writing and rehearsal period, which is a lot more than we had the first time. So we were able to actually go into the recording sessions being a little bit more prepared before we hit the record button.
Great album to record. Lots of fun in the studio, lots and lots of fun. Getting together, really. Unlike the first album, I had ideas of how much fun it can be to record in the way that Transatlantic records. And I got a lot more input, I feel, into this album.
Well, we sent out some demos. Roine did demos, and I did some demos, and we sent them around to each other. Pete did some demos as well. I think he just gave his demos to us when he got here, though, when he got to Nashville. We all convened here in White House, Tennessee. So, yeah, we kind of had some demos. We talked about it, but we weren't sure exactly what we were going to do or even what we were going to start with.
I did quite a lot of recording. On my own, in my own studio, I did lots of demos and put lots of things together and brought them along to the project. And I thought they were quite openly, listened to, which is nice.
When we decide to make a record, Neil get together, a set of tapes or a demo tape, and I do the same, and we send out the tapes to the other guys, and they have a chance to listen to the tracks, and we don't decide which tracks or what bits we're going to record. It's more like we leave it up to whenever we get together and we decide it later. So it's more like we have the chance of hearing the songs, but then when we get together for rehearsing before the recording, it's we try out different parts and then maybe hook a bit of mine onto a bit of Neil's and then a bit of Pete's, and
This is another thing that I suggested in the writing and rehearsals, was that Neil and Roine and Pete, all those guys had these really cool poppy bits and pieces, and I suggested, rather than taking a poppy piece and writing a little poppy piece, like something like what we did with Mystery Train. I guess on the first Transatlantic album, Mystery Train was kind of our Beatles-esque poppy song. I suggested, rather than just writing one little quick 5-minute song, why don't we, and only be limited to that one idea, why don't we take all these ideas and utilize them all into one big piece and kind of sprinkle it with a lot of prog overtones.
I think this album should have less Mystery Trains and more all of the above, but you take the Mystery Trains and you put them into all of the above.
Right.
So I would love to see an album of 3 20-minute pieces and then maybe one ballad rather than a lot of little ones. And you could take a lot of those little pieces and make them part of a big, giant, epic piece.
Right.
That's what I think.
Weren't you saying a little while ago you were just the drummer?
Yeah.
That was before the camera was running.
Right.
The thing I always worry about that is I don't want to, do something long just because people like long, I wouldn't want to take a song that, if it wants to be, it feels right for it to be short, I wouldn't want to just make it long just because we're a prog.
Well, how about the side 2 of Abbey Road approach?
Okay, well
that'd be great.
About,
where a big suite.
Yeah, how about fit it together in a way that makes sense. Yeah.
So a lot of little songs like side 2 of Abbey Road.
But what about
more of a big picture?
If you take Dark Side of the Moon, you've got very definite songs that are all running together.
Oh, there you go. Remember that from last time?
Oh, well, you should.
I'm sorry, go ahead.
Well, if you take something like Dark Side of the Moon, you've got definite songs, but they're all interlinked, so
Right, no, you've got a oneness.
I would love to do an interlinked album where themes cross over from the start of the album and continue to pop up
all the way through,
rather than confining them to only just one song, have themes being able to jump around throughout the entire album.
Yeah, I'm all for that.
We talked about it, and I suggested the idea of having themes not only reoccurring throughout the an individual song, but to reoccur and spread across the entire album, and that's something that Dream Theater has done many times, and I thought it could be a really cool thing for Transatlantic to do, to make an album have a feeling from start to finish, almost like a movie. So even though there's individual songs, the themes, The Stranger in Your Soul String, starting off Duel, and then The Motherless Children reappearing in Charlotte Pike, and then Lost and Found appearing in both Charlotte Pike and Stranger in Your Soul. Just that whole thing with song ideas jumping, from song to song within an album is just a real kind of conceptual way to writing. And even though it's not a concept album, it feels that way. So that was something that was suggested right from the get-go, and I think we incorporated it pretty well.
I think this is worthy of filming. Me setting up drums.
Yeah, this is like may never happen again.
And I'm absolutely clueless. This was all set up before I got here. All I've done is put these two cymbals on.
Right.
I'm baffled. It's not like I even said any of this.
I don't understand. Now, what is baffling you? It's like, Mike, you put the cymbals on the stand.
I don't understand, man. I can't figure it out.
Oh, it also surprised me that Mike couldn't figure out how to put his cymbals up. That was the funny thing. One of the funniest things I thought that happened was that it took Mike 2 hours just to put his cymbals on the stand.
Mike is actually putting something on.
How long has it been? It's been almost an hour.
Mike's putting a cymbal on.
Oh!
It's going. He's changed his mind.
I guess that'll do it.
Right. Oh, he's rubbed it out.
Those things are so cool. Let me just hit that down. Yeah.
Here he goes.
Man. One more Red Nightmare, dude.
Uh-oh.
Wah, 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 wah.
He has to have his hat on.
My thinking cap.
For me, the most definite song is, from what I've heard up to now, is this ballad.
Bridge to Forever.
Yeah. But then it's maybe, I don't know, maybe it's so much drumming on that one.
Right. Well, there's no drumming on that, actually.
No.
I really.
We could put
like
some
that.
In if you think.
I don't need to drum for the sake of it. But I really grew to like Hanging in the Balance.
Hanging in the Balance.
At first, the very first one, Neil's one.
Oh yeah, yeah.
That's
At first, it was like, okay, I like this, I don't like that, but I've grown to. I mean, now I'm like, I can't stop singing some of those parts. Those are totally hooky. So I mean, I totally want to do that one as well, for sure. I think there's a lot of cool things we could do with it. And there's already a lot of cool things there.
I tried to put it in the Dream Theater part, and that. Does that seem Dream Theater-y at all?
Yeah, a little bit.
It's heavier. I don't know. I was thinking of you the whole time I was doing it, Mike.
Oh, thank you. But now we're going to change it.
Yeah, let's change it. No, that's fine.
No, I really like a lot of that.
My concern about Hanging in the Balance, I don't know, there's some parts I'm not that crazy about, and there's some parts I think that are too Spocksy.
Definitely. I think one of the things...
We'd have to change it.
With this record, we got to be conscious of that. There's a lot of things... I think a lot of it, first of all, is your voice singing everything. I think maybe we should split up vocals a bit more on this.
Yeah, album. I'm with you.
But also, you have a definite style that, like, this. I'd like to change...
You can say Rut. It's okay.
believe me, I love everything you do. But I think we need to change some of that to make it more suited for this.
Absolutely.
There's a lot of Neal Morse cliches that are in some of these songs that we should get away from.
Probably the most enjoyable bit for me was working at Neal's house. We all got together there. And we just started arranging, really, and started listening through to what everybody was bringing to the session. And, you know, we had like 5 days or something stupid. We never give ourselves half as much time as we need. So we had about 5 days, I think, there to to try and learn how to play all this ridiculous music and then try and arrange it. And then we decided we'd record kind of demos of the songs to give us an idea of what they sounded like and where we were going with them. Because one thing that was really strange from the first album was that we'd just go in and record 10 minutes of music a day until we finished, you know, and it wasn't until we listened back to something that we actually knew what it sounded like, which is really, really bizarre and really quite dangerous. We were so lucky with the first album that everything just, you know, just seemed to fit together very well.
Duel with the Devil, that was actually the first song we began working on once the rehearsals and writing began. And originally, it wasn't even on the table for this album. Years ago, Neal sent me a demo of a song he had called Dance with the Devil. And the story has it, I believe, that he wrote it for Rio from Spock's Beard, and he never used it. But Neal turned me onto that song years ago, even before the first Transatlantic album. And right before we gathered in Nashville, I dusted off the old demos that Neal had given me years back, and that one really jumped out at me, and I always thought it was a cool song. So when we gathered in Nashville, nobody else had been prepared with that one, but I immediately said, hey, let's check this out. We popped in the demo, and we just dove right into it head first without much discussion. And obviously, the chorus changed. It used to be Dance with the Devil in the Pale Moonlight, which I think is a line out of the first Batman movie, but Neal changed it to Duel with the Devil. And although if you listen to the demo of it, which is on the limited edition Bridge Across Forever, you could hear that a lot of parts were changed or added from Roine's demos, and that's a perfect example of how this project works.
We wound up starting with Duel with what had been called Dance with the Devil, which was something I had written for Ryo Okamoto years ago, actually. I think it's from 97 or something. He asked me, he was thinking about doing a solo record and wanted some ELP kind of stuff. And so that's where I was coming from with that one, was a, you know, kind of a three-piece ELP deal. And but he wound up not recording it, so I think I put it on a disc to the TA guy.
Actually, once this theme comes in, it should turn around. The you know how when we first kick in, it's...
Yeah.
But once we get into this part, then the melody would be falling in a different place, like boom.
The good part for me is the getting together and the writing and arranging. Actually, not the writing. Writing can be fun, but arranging when it's going well is just that's the big buzz for me. Finding something and making it work and getting everybody in the room to sound as good as, you know, as good as they possibly can, and to get a piece of music really cooking. That is just the best thing in the world. And if you can actually get to a stage where you record it and it sounds just as good in the studio, then you're onto a winner, you know. Because that's the magic of producing, really. And this project, I think Transatlantic would be amazing if we had a really good producer. But I think we do a pretty good job ourselves.
It's day one at 7:45, and how much music have we actually...
6 bars!
Right, pretty much. Well, you know, Mike had to set up his own cymbals. I know not to have that happen again.
Like, even if we did that organ solo thing or some kind of solo section, and then we went in back into the...
Did you get lost again? Did you slide and did you hurt yourself? Do you need to have your diaper changed? Hey man, be careful when you're walking around, man. This is slippery.
Don't be careful when you're driving around, just when you're walking, okay?
You alright?
This is Luke. He's, this is Mike.
Luke, I am your father, Luke.
Is that scary?
I am your father.
Without my going to grandma's travel bag. Included in here is anything you might possibly need for a transatlantic session. Neil's demos, Roine's demos, here's Pete's demos. Where are my demos?
Yeah, where are your demos?
Right here. Transatlantic Floyd and Beatles covers. That's my contribution. Those are my demos every time around, the covers. Then, all the old Dream Theater session dats, which I'll, of course, tape over for more important things like this session. And, we're going to Grandma's. This is my daughter's, actually.
You mean more volume?
Yeah, maybe the bass guitar or something.
The way to point the speaker towards you guys, you were complaining earlier. You were whining about it, so...
Well, there you go.
Do you want to come back?
We'll have a bit of that.
We'll have a bit of that then. Okay, ready?
Thank you. took us quite a long time to sort out the beginning of that. That was the first thing we started to work on. And as I recall, it took us a long time just to get up, you know, to decide what we're going to do, just to get up to the where the vocal started. You know, I remember that took a while. Will you see you lose your sight?
Superimposing that on top of
It's the end of day two. We're still like in the middle of this thing. Mike's notes. Let's see, move that pen, see. Key intro, intro chords, intro groove, F progression, bagpipes. Look at all the different sections. These are all different sections. Verse one, verse two.
Those chords are great.
I found this studio owned by Robin Crow, a musician. I have this place not in the very center of Nashville, it's rather on the countryside, and it's like a wooden fortress, I would say. It's a very interesting building, and the very place we recorded is called the cabin. It's like the small studio.
He said pull all the way in for load in.
Okay, cool. Yeah. This is a bit bizarre.
Oh, it's really bizarre. That's why I thought we should be here.
Wow, this is like a huge kids play area, isn't it?
Roine. Roine from Sweden, and Pete Trewavas from England.
This is Luke, who's assisting us in shooting video and stuff.
I'm Ed.
Yeah. He's the first engineer, and Todd is second. So Ed and Todd, I thought with Roine's theme. Isn't this great? Get the surroundings, get the castle, man. It's so cool. The horses and everything. Nice view while you're recording.
Thank you.
far as where we recorded Dark Horse, at Dark Horse there in Franklin, Tennessee. Well, the initial thing that attracted me, I think, and that made Glenn Rosenstein want to introduce me to Robin was that Robin had been recording with John Anderson of Yes, and is a huge Yes fan. And so that was the first thing that, you know, brought us there.
Well, let's go! Let's do it, man. This is gonna be fun.
Instead of pumping on that thing, you're gonna try some. Wow. You guys are out there, man. stuff close enough for you.
You ready for some percussive brilliance to be laid onto this track, man?
Hey, how's the map of the world on your tongue today?
Today we're showing... Today we have a tour of Afghanistan going on, yeah.
Oh. I'll stay here while Sam wrestles the wild tongue.
Way back in the day. Word.
Word.
What's the word?
People haven't said word for about 10 years, man.
I haven't heard any of this.
No, you're probably best not to, actually.
I hope it's okay.
We just want to have dinner. We don't care.
Yeah.
Mike just brought so much enthusiasm along to the whole thing. He's just got bags of energy. And he walks in a room and there's this kind of cloud of energy. It's like a Tasmanian devil, you know. There's this kind of big cloud of energy moving around him, and you can't help but get caught up in it.
Where is the drummer? He's even dumber. Hey, go, 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 go. Go! Go!
Yeah.
Go!
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 Yeah.
Go!
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 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6.
Enjoy. I mean, I enjoy that piece. I like the way I really like that jam section, and Roine's wah-wah solo is just really cool. I think that's the one he did at the sessions. I don't think that's an overdub. I'm really glad he kept that one, because it really has a cool vibe to it.
The guitar that I recorded basic tracks and also some of the overdubs for the album, and it's a little bit different from, you know, other electric guitars that you may have seen, like the Fenders and stuff like that. So we take a closer look. This is actually a very slimline guitar, and it's, you know, lightweight. It has this acoustic pickup, so whenever you play the electric, you can just flip a switch and then, ta-da, you're into acoustic, and it actually sounds good.
Thank you.
originally the song didn't have the whole string intro as well. Originally that was just something that was written for Stranger in Your Soul. And then in the end, I suggested that maybe it could add to the continuous flow of the album to open the album. I knew I wanted to open with Duel with the Devil. In fact, I had to fight the guys on this. They wanted to all open up with Stranger in Your Soul. But I knew Duel was a great opener. Even though Stranger has an amazing opening section, Duel just has this really great prog, epic, you know, opening section. So I thought we had to definitely open the album with it. And sure enough, my fighting eventually wore them down, and I got my way, as always.
Yeah, at the end of Duel, where the choir comes in, that was Roine's idea as well. And I was like, I was ready to end it at that point, I think. I thought, oh, this is enough. Come on, let's figure out how to get out now, you know. And he said, oh no, let's do this building thing and have a choir come in and all this stuff. And I was like, okay, you know, whatever. And we just kind of did this framework that went on forever. And I was like, you know, I had no idea. You know, it wasn't until the last strokes of the brush.
Or whatever it's the. You know what? I'm not sure if it should be da 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 or da 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 da. So I'm gonna call. Hi, it's Neal. How are you doing? Good. I'm doing Mini Moog on Dance with the Devil. I'm doing the da 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 da. Do you want it? I thought it was da 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 da. Oh, okay, because on the track that's there, you go da 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 da. Oh, okay, so da 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 da, okay. Right. That's what I thought, but when I kept hearing something wrong and then I soloed up the guitar, I'm like, ooh. Okay, but it's a scratch track. Okay. Hey, my wife Sherry, this is Sherry. She's gonna help me because I can't hold the note and move both oscillators at the same time. I'm trying to basically do like a ring modulator sound.
So when it's a live concert.
That's good.
How do I know when to stop?
It doesn't matter. Just go with kind of with the tempo.
Yeah,
like da 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 da. 3, 4, 1, 2, 3. Keyboards on Transatlantic second album. something? Play it by itself. This is so amorous, and check it out.
Mirrors, come to play some saxophone on this thing. I hope this winds up being on the record. I haven't told anybody about this. I just heard it the other day. Yeah, let's try it. Chelsea Studios in Nashville. They think it's pretty funny that I'm filming myself. I told them I had to. It was in my contract. I did a bunch of the Spock things. I remember doing Flow in here. I did the last Transatlantic here as well. So the engineer was just asking me, what is this? Roll to 21 minutes, man. What are you guys writing, operas or what? Is this stuff going to film? He said, no, it's progressive rock, man. The longer it is, the better they'll like it. So. Thank you.
people have the impression that Neil is singing his songs and then I'm singing my songs. And I don't know where that leaves Mike and Pete, but in fact on this Bridge Across Forever, this album, I think it may be true in a sense, but at the same time I think I know for sure that that Neil sings some of the stuff that Pete did, and Pete sang some of the stuff that Neil wrote, and I sang some of the stuff that Pete wrote, I think, and I know that I sang on some of the stuff that Neil wrote, and he sang on some of mine, if I remember right. So I think it's a mix.
I really like some of Neil's vocals. I really like, he gets to sound, you know, really, really good. He gets that nice, what is it? It's kind of not American and not English, you know. There's a nice tone and a nice, nice approach vocally that just is really good, really nice. Not too Yes and not too, you know, more Beatley, more kind of, yeah, more how I think everyone should sing.
Try Duel with the Devil. Duel doesn't sing as well. Duel with the Devil. Duel with the Devil. It was Dance with the Devil by the Pale Moonlight, but it seems so cliche. And I don't really like it. I never did. I'm going to say Duel with the Devil Living in Your Mind. That's inside your mind. Have you woke up screaming in the silence of the night? You wish you could start dreaming in clouds of white, but everything could change tonight. Clouds of white, but everything could change tonight. When you duel with the devil living in your mind.
Sweet Charlotte Pike is, I think, is maybe the evidence that all four members listen to have listened to and are listening to the Beatles still.
Charlotte Pike, for me, was a lot of fun because I love the Beatles and I love being able to kind of play in that groove, that whole Ringo vibe, and I can never really do that with Dream Theater. So for me, Transatlantic is the perfect outlet to do that kind of thing, and this song totally capitalized on it.
So, this is something I thought of this week.
If she runs, then I run.
Charlotte Pike, that was something that I probably wouldn't have even done. If it wasn't, that was really Mike wanted to continue on. I would have, after the first two epics, I would have said, okay, that's 52 minutes, that's enough. I would have said, I would have called it a day at that. But Mike wanted to keep going and put those, you know, kind of Beatlesque rock songs together. And that was really Mike's brainchild. I think, you know, he sat with everybody's demos and kind of thought about where we could put it together. And I think it came out really cool.
Sweet Charlotte Pike was our kind of ode to Abbey Road. In fact, the title is a direct homage to Abbey Road, because Charlotte Pike is actually the name of the road or the street that Dark Horse Studios, where we recorded the album, is. So, you know, they had their Abbey Road. That was where they recorded that album. And we have our Charlotte Pike, which is where we recorded this album. But the whole idea was to do like what's done on side two of Abbey Road, take a lot of little songs and combine them to one epic piece.
I think I got most involved with Charlotte Pike. That was kind of, I had enough. Well, we all had a similar idea, actually. I can't remember who voiced it. It might have been me, actually. It might have been someone else. But, you know, we're all into that kind of Abbey Road type thing. And why don't we do that kind of approach ourselves? And rather than try and arrange loads of pieces of music in a very clever way to become a progressive thing, just literally bolt sections together, and that's what we did.
Thing though, just jam and then like just go.
If she runs.
Well, I think that's the way they
I
should.
Got the tail end of that jam.
I had the whole thing actually, but I think that should be the approach. That's the way, once we have all the pieces, we'll know what
laying down the tracks, as usual, you know, Mike wanted to work as quick as we, you know, quicker than we possibly could, actually. But, you know, we got into a pretty feisty kind of routine.
Oh, come on.
Mike's like I was yesterday, right?
Right. We don't know what we're going to do. You want to just...
Come on, let's do it. We don't know what we're doing. Come on, let's go.
At least we'll get the
camera. Yeah, baby. Okay. Let's go, Admiral. Take Mrs. Robinson. Take one. Let's go.
It's important to get, you know, a good sound that you can, you know, just lean back and actually enjoy the sound you're playing. And in that sense, I think Dark Horse was a good choice of a studio, because the guys, as I said, were fast, they were professionals, and they set up a really nice sound. So it's nice to just play the music, and what you hear from the speakers is it really sounds good from the start. If she
come on.
got Mike doing vocals here. And Neal is going to be egging him on. Go ahead, settle a little bit here. Is that where it was?
Coming up on the screen changes.
Yeah, that's the right place. Here we go. 1, 2, 3.
It's
production is very Abbey Road-esque, you know, just with the different sounds, different keyboard and guitar sounds. The vocals, all four of us are getting to sing. I even got to pay tribute to my kids, immortalize Melody and Max in one of the lyrics, which was very cool. Now there'll probably be transatlantic fans all across the world naming their twin kids Melody and Max because of that song, kind of like Jack and Diane, John Cougar.
The Beatles influences you hear on Bridge Across Forever and maybe even on the first album, I don't think that we intentionally ever try to make something that is, you know, Beatles. It's more like just happens that, you know, the four of us, we love the Beatles. And that's the way it came out. I mean, it's influences from the Beatles, but also other groups from the rock history, and obviously some of the progressive groups of the 70s. You can hear echoes from that, and I mean Pink Floyd or Queen or Genesis. And Beatles is just another influence, something that we all share in the band, you know.
Yeah, the melody.
Is that what you want, or?
Dum bum bum. Dee 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 dum.
Where?
Second round. Yeah. And what's that? The last chord you played? Will you place you? Come in late. They're coming in late, sorry.
You can hear how they're supposed to be right in.
It's all just 1, 2.
Do you want me to give you another ring? Are they way later to just slide
noise? They're late about 2 beats or something. Anyway, I'm gonna leave.
Yeah. Okay? Yeah.
Cool?
We'll work it out.
Transit my way!
The morning person and the night person. You know, I'm like, I wanna go to bed now.
If she runs, let her run, 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 and just hope that she comes back. If she breaks, let her break, 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 let her apologies attract. And if she's free, let her be, let her be. She's not in such bad company. The big man still got her name written on the wall. If she cries, let her cry, 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 till there isn't any more. if she laughs, then I crack. If that's what she's looking for. And if she waits, let her wait, let her wait. You'll have to leave this one to fade. It can't ever be too late. When she comes to call.
So the case of not having enough lyrics, I just wrote this, scratched out this, in the Temple of the Gods. We can get it on in the Temple of the Gods. We will make our home. Does that rhyme? Far from these boulevards, we will plunge headlong. I don't know. I'm gonna sing it and see how it feels.
In the temple of the gods, we can get it all. In the temple of the gods, we will make our home. Far from the boulevard, we will plunge headlong. Song. Yeah.
Hey, I like that yeah at the end.
The time has come. The big man's got the mother and the son written on the wall.
Gotta leave some room for the other guys, right? Yeah, I gotta leave some work for them to do. Okay. I'm done. Later. It's finished March 12th. Okay.
Bridge Across Forever is a song that I wrote many years ago. And I had written it by myself, and then I brought it. I was working with this female artist, Celeste Prince, who I actually haven't been able to find anywhere. All of the numbers I have on her aren't good anymore, and I even like searched on the internet. So I don't know where she is. I want to tell her that we have this song on this album.
Beautiful song, though. Kind of like the equivalent to We All Need Some Light Now from the first Transatlantic album. It's one of those things that we heard the demo, Neal's demo, and it was like, you know, what can we do? There's no reason to change this. This is a beautiful song, and we did that with We All Need Some Light. Same thing with this song. It was just something Neal had. It was beautiful. To change it would just completely ruin it, so we let it be, and you know, proud to include it on our album, and ultimately ended up naming the album after it, not because it's this big title track, but just because it's a great title with a lot of imagery to it.
It's a fantastic song, isn't it, Bridge? It made me cry when I first heard it. I heard Neal's demo months ago now, obviously. He sent me through demos of all of his stuff. Loads of bits we didn't use, actually. And the same with Roine, loads of stuff of his that we didn't even get into because they were just, you know, it wasn't time in the day, really. We need twice as much time, as I said before. But I remember putting Neal's stuff on, and the first thing that hit me was Bridge is a lovely song. And it's going to make me cry now, just talking about it.
There's a bridge made of light that crosses between death and life. My shadows walk in the sun, and desperate lovers child and an angel stood on either side of a magic river, but there is no crossing. But as they tried, the water began to rise, and they raised their as the river fell away, they built a bridge across forever. Between tomorrow and today, there is a bridge across forever. A bridge across forever. This dream all my life that doesn't live in black and white. It never ends, it just begins in distant sands and magenta winds. On the bridge across forever, I know that we will find a way to the bridge across forever. Between tomorrow and forever, I know that we will find our way to the bridge across forever, the bridge across forever.
Stranger in Your Soul, I think, is, well, that's my favorite cut. Oh, back to the album order I would have wanted. Yeah, I would have had it be Stranger in Your Soul, Bridge Across Forever, Duel with the Devil, and then Sweet Charlie Pike at the end. That's probably what I would have done, I think. But Mike wanted this order on the album so much that he, like, took himself out of voting on artwork and... He said, I'll do whatever you guys want as long as I can have my my album order. So that was that's what the way it went down. He felt really, really strongly that it needed to be that way.
I think you'll like this.
if the drums don't fully kick in to that until the pedal picks up. Do-do-do-do-do-do.
I would have sequenced the record a lot different. I would have put Stranger in Your Soul first, because I think the intro to Stranger in Your Soul is like this one of the strongest things that we did. And I was against it. I remember that. I remember at the suggestion of the string thing going into the drums and bass thing, I was like, huh? That just didn't make any sense to me. And then that was one of those like, okay, just go with the flow, go with the band, and it'll all turn out for the better. And it certainly did. I mean, that came out just great, the way they kind of fade in. I think that was Roine's idea.
Let me hear it, like, how you have it from this. How does it kick in?
My idea was that the drums and bass actually started from the string.
Yeah, kind of a groovy.
Can I do that?
Yeah, sure, maybe take a tambourine on top.
Wow. You really want to do that? Should double the chords. I'm quite enjoying it with the drums being fast and the chords playing slowly. And when we go to the chords playing faster, it seems a bit corny to me.
Yeah, I know what you mean.
It's a bit like, hey, here we are in Jolly Land.
Yeah, get a little too happy.
Yeah, I think you guys should continue your pace and just build
just
the inversions and
starship thing.
Yeah.
Stranger in Your Soul, I think, is probably my favorite song on the album, maybe even my favorite song that Transatlantic has put together. Once again, it stemmed from another song or demo that Neal brought in, but once again, like Duel with the Devil, it stemmed from Neal, but so many of the parts and pieces and even the songs within the songs came from Roine and Pete's demos as well. Neal's original version of it was called Hanging in the Balance, and it had a lot of the same parts. It had the whole Hanging in the Balance and the Stranger in Your Soul. It had a lot of those bits, but a lot of other things as well that we didn't use. And then there was a lot of parts that we brought in from the other guys. Like Pete brought in the whole intro thing, that whole Genesis. I don't know if I have the right key, but that whole thing came from one of Pete's demos, and it was, you know, another collaborative effort.
for that, don't you think?
Yes. Let's go in like a couple fills after where we went in before. The first couple were good. Okay, I'll just put you, we'll just put you in. I'll point. Yeah. All right.
After the really cool, unusual.
After the really cool, bump, 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 bump thing. Okay. Right. Okay.
It's now Sunday. Hi, don't mind me, guys.
So you want to go before, get in before this, or right here? Now, and keep going.
What time is it?
Where are we?
Quarter to three. And Pete's honing in on some bass stuff here.
Oh, sorry. No, I want to go back to where we dropped in before and get out there.
Oh, okay. Let's see.
And I was just... on the way here, my family came down today, so I was spending a little time with them this morning.
It's in my mind, it should be and, yours too.
On the way here, I was getting all these lyric ideas for the first song, and I started scrawling these things out while I was like driving, which is very dangerous. This would be once not so long ago, I lived far below who I am. You know, it's on the back of my mother-in-law's bank statement. What do we got here? Look at that. Oh, that's nice.
Still you don't believe. And then next chorus. I think, and when you feel ashamed, you will be assured. Like, you don't believe that.
Yeah.
And when you strain your voice, you will surely be heard. Mm-hmm. You know, like, that whole thing. I'm wondering if... First, it's sort of odd that the whole thing is I, from the I perspective.
I know.
And then it's from... Then I just switch right to the you perspective. It's like, this is me, like, telling my story of how I used to feel... And this is like God talking to me now or something, yeah. You know.
So we were able to go into the recording sessions a bit more prepared before we hit the record button this time. And this time around, I think there was a lot more variety in terms of the different bits and pieces that were incorporated into the music. With the first album, an example was, you know, maybe a song like All of the Above, where Mystery Train was basically something Neil had, and then we would kind of shape it and, you know, add our 2 cents here and there, but for the most part it was true to his original demo or song, or in the case of the first album with Roine and My New World. This time around, we did have everybody's demos to prepare us, but songs like Duel with the Devil and Stranger in Your Soul were not so much one person song with just a little bit of contributions from each of us. It was more like, you know, a bit of Neil's song combined with a bit of Roine's song with a bit of Pete's, you know, demo, and basically we threw all these things in together.
One of the main things I thought was really cool that came together was Pete's theme in Stranger in Your Soul and fitting into what was there. That whole melding of those two things, you know, from the once not so long ago to the but I can't hear it now. That really surprised me. You know, I thought I had that ending to that thing just exactly the way it was, should have been on the demo. And then, but when then we went into that, I mean, it just, it took it so much further, you know, when we went into Pete's theme at the end and then I might be away, da 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 da. You know, that I think we all just kind of musically climaxed, essentially, at that point. Hopefully the audience will too. That was a big moment, I think, for all of us. You know, when that all just kind of fit together, we all went, wow.
That was pretty good.
That's the best fucking song I've ever written.
Hey!
Hi.
This is Chris Carmichael.
Howdy.
It's February something.
14th.
Oh, it's Valentine's Day.
Yeah.
Yeah, I guess I should know that. Yeah, Valentine's Day, 2001, and we're working on the beginning, very beginning of, I think it's going to be called Stranger in Your Soul, so.
Introduction?
1, 2, 3, 4.
Thank you.
I think there was also a conscious effort to split up the vocal parts as much as possible. So it wasn't so much always Neal singing. We wanted to split it up to have lots of different voices, so the songs didn't sound like a, you know, Spock Beard album or a Flower King's album. Adding mine and Pete's voices, especially with some of the occasional lead parts, really just helped give it a bit of more of its own identity.
Don't you think if you could be lost? Don't you think that you could be found? Don't you think if you were the world, you'd turn it around? Don't you think if you could be lost? Don't you think that you could be found? Don't you think if you were the world, you'd turn it around? Whatever you want to change, you better start changing your mind. Cause everything can be done. Stand up, cause this is your time.
Yeah, okay, let's have a little more.
Less can live and more doesn't satisfy.
It's a deeper feeling.
Lose if you want to find what you're looking for.
All your dreams can live is to satisfy the meaning.
I really like the quiet awakening a stranger in your soul. That section. Yeah, Awakening the Stranger section. That's beautiful, isn't it?
Well, this is sort of interesting, maybe. Because, like, the lyric sheets all just scrawled out. And I don't even know exactly, I'm going to start vocals, I'm going to start singing now, but I'm not sure what I want to say or what I hope that, because we don't really write lyrics together. So, let's see what I've got. I've sort of wrote some stuff out while. So once, not so long ago, I lived far below who I am. Guess I'm going to think about this. I just wrote this. I had a bunch of other stuff, and I only liked some of it. For Stranger in Your Soul. I just wrote this, the second half.
Home was far away, sleeping wide awake, breaking down, waiting for the sound.
This is Pete's thing, I think, was originally,
don't want to hear it now, but I can't hear it now. Is it all too late? Because I would sell my dreams if I could be awake.
That's pretty cool. Man, that took me a long. I mean, it's been like an hour. I think. I had a bunch of different things, but I can't hear it now. Not a single word. Anyway, I like the second verse. It doesn't really make any sense, but
they're marching through the malls, pointing out the pain. Here we are. Reaching through the rain.
That's cool, I think.
I almost got a glimpse to feel that Sunday high. I would fall. This makes no sense at all. Once, not so long ago, I lived far below where you are. I did indeed. No, home was far away. I was sleeping wide awake, breaking down, waiting for the sound.
But I can hear
marching through the walls, pointing out the pain. Here we are, reaching through the rain. I almost caught a glimpse to feel that Sunday high I would fall. This makes no sense at all.
When it's all going well, it all goes particularly well, you know, which is nice. It's always nice. But with this band, you know, there's such potential. We still haven't even got halfway near where we could go with it.
It's very exciting.
I'm totally proud of both Transatlantic albums, and I don't know what the future holds. I would love to make more albums, although I gotta admit honestly that I wouldn't mind waiting a little bit before we did another one in order to make it special. I don't want it to be something that's expected every year, because, you know, then the whole excitement of it would wear off. So I honestly wouldn't mind waiting a little bit before we do another album together, but I surely would love to do another one or more in the future, you know, through the years. Because I think there is a real magic and a real chemistry between the four of us.